chapter 9. What kind of man would you like to be? Well, what kind of man are you tonight? Verse 6, 1 Samuel 9, 6. And he said unto him, behold, now there is in this city a man of God. Think about that. I don't know, that just kind of registered on them. So there's in this city right now a man of God. Well, they were scarce back there then. And they're still scarce, too. It's hard to find a real man of God. I mean a man that doesn't fear anything but the disfavor of God and doesn't desire anything but the righteousness of Christ. I mean, it's hard to find a real man of God that's sold out and completely dead to the world. Now, what kind of man would he be? There's in this city a man of God. Well, what kind of man is a man of God? Why, he's an honorable man. All that he saith cometh surely to pass. A man of God's an honorable man. He'll pay his debts, treat his family right. He'll love his neighbor, and everything he says will come to pass. You just put her down. Brother, he'll never lie. He'll never lie. That's an honorable man. You know who he's talking about? He's talking about that old prophet. You know where that old prophet came from? He came from a woman that fell on her knees, Brother Robert, and fell down at the altar, and she began to pray. And I want you to know she stayed on her knees till God said, all right, I'll give you a son. I'll give you a son. And listen, you know what she did? She gave that son to the preacher and said, now you train him, give him the best there is to be given. That's Brother Samuel. Ah, no, one of the Lord said to little Samuel, Samuel? Samuel, he said, speak, Lord. Thy servant's listening. Mothers and daddies, you might as well put it down. We're responsible for the way our children live. And I tell you who's to blame for every daddy, for every boy. I believe more than anybody else. Now, I know it's hard to say sometime and it's heartbreaking, but listen. If you daddies would get as interested in your white-faced children as you are your white-faced cattle, or you'd get as interested in your family as you are your business, and realize that your main business is your family, I'll guarantee you we'd come up with better kids. We'd come up with better children. I mean, if you just say, now listen here, I don't have to make 15,000. I'd rather make 10,000 and be with my family and pray with my family and worship with my family, because I'll tell you what, you'll spend most of your money at the end of the trail trying to buy back what you sold out down the road. You watch and see. I know, I've already been there. Listen, you can't imagine at the thousands and thousands. I've seen old gray-haired saints of God that spent every dime they got. Said, I can't pay off anymore. I can't hire any more lawyers. I can't fight through any more cases. It's already gone. Listen, you turn with me to the 6th chapter of the book of Genesis and I want to show you what happened. Now, God said, I want to make man in my own image, and he did. In the 6th chapter of the book of Genesis and verse 3, we find these words, and the Lord said, my spirit shall not always strive with man, for he's flesh, yet his days shall be 120 years. Now then you go to the 7th verse. The 7th verse. And the Lord said, I'll destroy what? Man, whom I've created from the face of the earth, both man and beast, and the creeping thing, and the fowls of the air, for it repenteth me that I have made them. Did you know that everything on this earth has suffered to the extent that man has gone away from God? That includes the wife, the children, the animal creation. Everything suffers when man goes away from God. Now then, turn with me, please, to the 8th chapter. The 8th chapter of the book of Genesis and verse 21. And the Lord smelled a sweet savor, and the Lord said in his heart, I will not again curse the ground anymore for man's sake. The ground was cursed for whose sake? Man's sake. And now then, the soil has been raped. It's been taken advantage of. We've just about ruined it, and now then we're trying to live off of poison soil. And America, with every hospital running over, every insane institution filled, every jailhouse, every penitentiary filled tonight. Why? Man got out of the will of God. Now then, I want you to look at 2 Samuel chapter 12. 2 Samuel chapter 12. Now this is real, pointed, pungent, powerful preaching. And yet it was needed. There was a man in the Old Testament. The Bible said he was a man after God's own heart. I think two of the greatest compliments ever paid any two men was the fact that Abraham was the friend of God and David was a man after God's own heart. You know, it used to bother me. I used to wonder, well, how in the world Could David be a man after God's own heart? When he did what he did, he was guilty of adultery. He was guilty of murder. And he broke up a man's home. And what a sin. And yet God said, he's a man after my heart. But dear friend, if you'll read the life of David and count his tears and count his psalms, especially 51st Psalm, and that's one psalm all of us ought to memorize. If you'll memorize the 51st Psalm, you'll find out David is crying after the heart of God. Lord, my heart, oh, against thee and thee only have I done this evil and sinned against you. My sins, I acknowledge it's ever before you. And he just cries and cries and weeps. And you hear him praying almost like Jesus when he said, oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem. And he was saying, oh, Absalom, my son, Absalom. My boy's dead. And I imagine David went to bed a many a night weeping, crying, and saying, will I never stop reaping what I've sown? Brother, those old chickens sure did come home to roost. And America's chickens are coming home to roost tonight. Put her down. And there was a prophet. Yeah, that's right. A man of God. His name was Nathan. God said, Nathan, I want you to run an errand for me. Deliver a message. He said, yes, sir. I'm ready. And he marched off to the king, too, didn't he? And he came into his presence. He didn't say, your honor, I sure do regret to inform you, and it's hard to deliver this message. He just went in and said, King David, he said there was a rich man. Said he had a lot of sheep, a lot of lambs, a lot of cattle. Said he just rolling in. Said he had it made. Said he's just in good shape. But he said, you know, down the road, there's a fellow worked for him, and he said, he got a little old ewe lamb. He didn't have any toys and so forth for the children. He got a little old ewe lamb and took it down there. Maybe the master gave it to him. And said that little old ewe lamb just kind of came up with his children, said he just tussled and played with it and had such a good time. And said, I guess it was about the nicest toy they ever had. And he said, you know, one day, King David said, the rich man up on the hill said he had guests coming in. Said, my, tremendous guests. And he said, you know, I want the best meat that we can have. I mean, I want to serve a table. And he said, I tell you what we better do. You go down and get that little old ewe lamb. I mean, it'll be sort of kitchen fed, you know, and home fed, and it's well cared for. You go down there and get that little lamb and kill it, and I tell you, we'll put it on the table. And I mean, my imagination, of course, has gone down to that house many a time. And I followed the fellow down, the servant went down there, you know, and he said, you know, to the man, said, I've come to get that lamb. Yes, sir. He said, sure. He said, what do you want? He said, the king wants it. He said, fine. He said, that's good. He thought the king, you know, was just going to kind of look at the lamb because it's in such good shape and say, now, this is a prize-winning lamb. You know, this is a thoroughbred and well cared for and everything. He said, we're going to kill. He said, what? Yeah, he said, we're going to have this for dinner tonight. He said, we got guests coming. He said, the king wants to kill. No, he said, you wouldn't do that, would you? Well, about that time, I hear all the little children start crying. They said, Daddy, you won't let him kill our little lamb, will you? It's all we got. It's all we got to play with. Said, why, the man said, listen, sir, excuse me, please. I sure don't want to be disobedient. But said, you know good and well, this little lamb's like one of my family. Said, I've nursed it, you know. I probably put it on a bottle and maybe just took care of it when it's so small. Mother might have died. Said, said, listen, look at the lambs and sheep and all that you got out across the pasture. No, said, you told me to get this one right here. Nathan said, you know, they drug that little old lamb up the road, and those little children were leaning up against the fence crying, tears was rolling. And said even the mother and the daddy stood there and tried to console their children and wept with them. The little lamb, boy, listen, old David, you know, he was the man, his hair's by sticking up. He said, who is the man? Who did that? Thou art the man. You're the man I'm talking about. That's preaching, isn't it? I mean, that's using the single barrel shotgun. That's not scatter loading, boys. That's what men need. That's what you and I need. He shot him in the heart. Did you know that? I mean, he riddled his heart. He said, David, you know good and well you lived in the palace. You had everything in this world that a king could ever. You've got power unlimited. You've had wives and selections and choices. You could have gotten anybody. But I tell you what you did. You climbed up on your big roof garden and turned on your little silly television set. And you looked down there and you saw Bathsheba. and she was rather exposed, and you lusted and you desired her and you took her, you knew she was another man's wife, the only wife he had, the only little lamb he had, and you took her up here and got her in sin, and now then she's expecting a baby, and now you sent her husband off to get him killed. You're the man! David, I think, fell to his knees, said, I'm guilty. I'm guilty. David could have killed Nathan as dead as a hammer, but he didn't. I think David said, I've killed all ever I want to kill. In my heart, he began to plead, brother, thou art the man. Let me ask you this tonight. How many of you men have hidden sin in your heart? You know good and well you're guilty before God. You've not been willing to confess or forsake and turn away from the sin that's blackened your soul. It may not be the sin of David, but it may be some little old nasty, ugly, filthy, ungodly, secret, crooked sin that you don't want anybody to know about, but God knows about it. Thou art the man, Nathan would say. Oh, listen to me. What about it tonight? What about it tonight? Now then, I want you to turn to John chapter 19, and I'd like to look at the real man. I'd like to look at the man of the ages tonight. I'd like for us to see the only man that's ever really met all of my needs. My daddy was the biggest man. I mean, the best man. And seemed like the most honest man, the hardest working man. I mean, my daddy had a lot of superlatives to him because I was his son, you know. And I mean, I respected my daddy. I thought he could pick more cotton, hoe more cotton, plow more cotton. He could just seem like do more things than anybody I've ever seen on the farm. I mean, he really got after it. And he taught us boys to work. But you know, there's some things my daddy could not do for me. I never was quite satisfied just to be the son of Mr. H.A. Roloff. I was miserable. I used to go out and come in, ashamed, disappointed, and in despair. Until one night, I met this man that I'm fixing to talk to you about tonight. And fellas, if you want to be a real, good, and godly man, you'll have to get introduced to this man. In the 19th chapter of the book of John, and verse 5, here it is, then came Jesus forth, wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe, and Pilate saith unto them, behold the man. There he is. Yes, he's got a crown. He's wearing a crown. Thank God he's going to wear another crown one of these days. That old crown, instead of stars and diamonds, it had thorns. But he's the man. You know what kind of man he was? He was a man that was virgin born. You know what kind of man he was? He was a man that never sinned one time. You know what kind of man he was? He was a man that never had a place to lay his head. Yet he never sounded a low note or felt sorry for himself. You know what kind of man he was? He was a man that loved everybody and was kind and respectable to women and to men and boys and would have been the finest husband and father that ever lived, and yet he never had a wife. He loved children more than any man that ever lived, and he'd sit all over his knees. He'd place his hands on their little heads and say, God bless you. God bless you. Oh, I can hear him now as he said, God bless your little sweetheart. Oh, how precious are these children. His disciples said, why don't you get these kids back out of the way? He said, you permit little children to come to me and forbid them not, for such is the kingdom of heaven. I love these little children. There's something mean about a man that won't love little children. Did you know that? I've always governed my ministry by two people. You know who they are? Grandpa and the little child. Those are the two people that have governed and judged my ministry. If the little children love me and believe in me and will listen to me and come back to hear me, and if old grandpa, the old great talk, I mean if a man who's had the frost of many winters to settle on his old head, he's been through deep valleys and dark shadows, if that old man will come to me with that old feeble hand, and his old precious wrinkled-faced wife will come and slip her arm maybe over my shoulder, say, God bless you, son. You preach the truth. That crowd are on my first string. It's not this little bunch of wild outfits, you know. It's not this bunch of worldly folks that want to drift and sow their wild oats. They don't govern. They'll criticize and they'll say, I think you're a little... You're out of line. Yeah, that's right. Somebody said the other day, a fellow was in a certain church and he got up. He said, you're out of order. I said, whose order? I said, I believe I'm in God's order. And I do too. Dear friends, I found out that when I get over in God's order, I sure am out of order with a bunch of people left in this old land. The steps of a good man are ordered of the Lord. He said, behold the man. You know who this man is? He's God's son. He came all the way from glory, closed up heaven for a while, so far as he's concerned, left the fellowship of the Father and the hails of the angels for the nails of wicked religious men. That's Jesus. Behold the man. Jesus never saw a case he couldn't solve, a doubt he couldn't erase, a soul he couldn't save, a child he couldn't heal, a blind man whose eyes he could not open, unstopped deaf ears, raised the dead, fed the multitudes, and made no charge. Behold the man. Brother, that's the man you need to know tonight. That's the man that I want to walk with tonight. All other men fade and pale into insignificance when Jesus comes walking up. Stood at the end of life's runway with that pure, sweet, precious, open face. Wept more than probably any man that ever lived because of men's sins. While they crucified him, he prayed for them. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Behold the man. Oh, that unusual, wonderful, eternal darling of God that came to give himself to make us men what we ought to be for the Lord Jesus Christ. But that's not all. His chin finally fell on his chest, and they said, he's dead. Take him down. But oh, listen, dear friend. They said, we better get somebody to guard that tomb. They got 16 soldiers to take care of the lowly man of Galilee. Dead, who wasn't even breathing, took his limp body. Those hands that had lifted the burdens, and broken the bread, and raised the dead. I said, they took that man that healed all the sick, cared for the people like they'd never been cared for before. The multitudes followed him, leaned on his words. He saved Gadarene demoniacs. Yes, that man. And yet, you know what they charged him for that? Death. You know what religion said? We'll kill him. We'll kill him. And they did. Oh, they laid him in the tomb, dusted off their hands and said, well, it's good to be rid of him. He's caused us a lot of trouble. You're not rid of him yet. 16 big old soldiers gathered around that tomb and had their swords, and I can hear them now with their godless talk as they spit into the fire on that cool night and said, I'd like to see him get up. I wish he would. I'd whittle him down to his normal size. And about that time, the old Roman seal began to quiver. One of them looked over and said, am I seeing things? And 15 said, if you are, we are too. And all of a sudden, that old Roman seal cracked wide open, boys. Thank God for the power of Calvary. The blood of the everlasting covenant got a hold of Jesus, lifted him up. He walked out and said, good morning. The fellows fell back like dead men. Like dead men. Behold the man. Brother, that's the man. That's the man. I tell you, I'm glad I know him tonight. I'm glad he saved me. I'm glad he'd take a little old ignorant, sick country boy that didn't want to go to the meeting that night and grip my soul with his gospel and save me and wash my sins away, write my name in the Lamb's Book of Life, and set my feet on solid rock. Behold the man. I'm glad I know him tonight. He's my chiefest and choicest friend. He's the only man I ever met that met all of my needs. I got everything I was hungry for in one package when I believed on the Lord Jesus Christ. That same wonderful man called me one Wednesday night to preach his gospel. Let me load a little Jersey cow in an old trailer, haul her off to Baylor, milk my way through school. He healed my body and made me strong and gave me journeying mercies and open doors. And behold the man. Behold the man. Oh, no mortal can with him compare among the sons of men. Fairer is he than all the fair who fill that heavenly train. who filled that heavenly train. He saw me plunge in deep distress, and he flew to my relief. For me he bore that old shameful cross, and he carried all my grief. He carried all my grief.
I've seen the lightning flashing and heard the thunder roll. I've felt sin's breakers dashing, trying to conquer my soul. I've heard the voice of my Savior telling me still to fight on. He promised never to leave me, never to leave me alone. No, never alone. No, never alone. He promised never to leave me, never to leave me alone. No, never alone. No, never alone. He promised never to leave me, never to leave me alone. He died for me on the mountain, for me they pierced his side. For me he opened the fountain, the crimson cleansing tide. For me he's waiting in glory, seated upon his throne. He promised never to leave me, never to leave me alone. No, never alone. No, never alone. He promised never to leave me, never to leave me alone. No, never alone. No, never alone. He promised never to leave me, never to leave me.
You've been listening to the Family Altar Program with Evangelist Lester Roloff, coming from Corpus Christi, Texas. You may have a part in the ministry by writing to Brother Roloff. The address is Box 1177, Corpus Christi, Texas.
Tempted and tried, we're all made to wonder why it should be thus all the day long. While there are others living about us, never molested, though in the wrong. Father, we shall meet.
Yeah.